Hey, welcome to Liquid Lunch. Here we are live. It is Tuesday, February 26th, 2012. 2013! I said 2012. See, we've been so fixated on 2012.
And we're still here. But are we?
Yeah, exactly. That's what I was going to say.
Really here?
I don't think we're really here.
I know you're not. I don't know. You know what?
What?
You didn't lower my chair today. I'm a little higher than you.
No, you're not. Look on the TV.
Okay.
You're sitting up straight now.
See, now you're going to move your chair. See?
Because you're sitting up straight.
You always move me down lower.
No, you do. Okay. Anyway.
How are you?
I'm good.
Awesome.
Yeah,
you know
doing?
What? We have only 2 days left in this month, and then we're into March.
Which is bad news for people that are worried about their bills. You know?
Oh,
you know what
right,
I mean?
Right.
Bill payment time.
Okay, but just get over that hump. Because we're hitting spring.
That's right.
And you know what? Today feels actually like a spring
actually,
day.
It does. In fact, I got out today. I missed my bus, and I was thought, hey, it's so nice that I'm going to ride my bike. Right?
Awesome. And
but
did you?
No, because there's a snowstorm coming. Isn't there?
No. We're not allowing that to happen.
Okay.
There's no snowstorm.
Let's get busy with the show, because we've got a really busy show. We have Lori Kennedy is here. We're talking about the Wellness Business Summit.
Oh, wow. Awesome.
And also Lorene Soro.
Okay.
No relation to Sauron. From CanPro, also involved with this summit. They're going to be coming on in a little bit. Also, the amazing Kreskin is coming on the show. Do you remember Kreskin?
No way.
Yeah.
There is no amazing Kreskin here today.
He's going to be here.
Get out of town. Okay, this is a joke. I'm just
no, it's not a joke.
Punchline.
He's going to be coming on, and we're going to be talking about what's going to be happening in 2013.
No way. Like
yes, we are.
The?
Yeah, the Kreskin.
No, because I know you're pulling my leg.
You'll find out.
Because I love that man. I grew up.
Really?
I love that man.
Well, he's coming on the show.
Wow, that's almost like, okay, I shouldn't say this, but John of God.
Well, if we try to get a big name.
Oh, my God.
Every week. Not
are
that
you
the
serious?
Rest.
Okay, now I'm totally gullible and I'm totally 100% believing you.
Good.
Okay, this is not true.
Okay. Also,
setting me up.
Val Shearman and Max Brand will be
Yay,
on.
Yay! Our two favorite people!
And we're also expecting a Vancouver musician named Adam Jang to come on the show, although...
He's in town, I'm assuming.
I think he's in town.
Okay.
But I don't know because Mercury's retrograde. Some of these communications are getting lost in the shuffle.
Yeah, but that means things are backwards?
Mercury's going backwards.
Okay. So does that count for if you're in Vancouver because time is backwards?
Yeah. They're actually ahead of us.
3 hours back.
They're
no.
3 hours ahead now because it's backwards.
Oh, okay.
Right?
It's the pole shift thing.
Exactly.
Right?
Okay, but we're going to start the show off. Glenn Allen and Chris Burkett are here, and we've got it's the Mint Film Festival, the Made in Toronto Film Festival, and we've got a trailer we're going to play right now. We're going to come back with Glenn and Chris as Liquid Lunch gets underway on a Tuesday. What else is
beautiful,
new?
Beautiful, no snow Tuesday.
Not yet.
Not coming.
There are moments in history where great civilizations are tasked with reinventing themselves or risking collapse.
We die emotionally, we die financially. It's killing me to look at my kids and know that they might not have nothing for real.
This same mentality that trashes people trashes the planet.
What's wrong with us as a species?
Many people are losing hope and they know how bad the situation is. How can the crisis be transformed into perhaps the greatest love story on earth?
Good morning, Occupy Wall Street!
Good morning, Occupy Wall Street!
Good morning, planet Earth!
This movement against the Keystone XL pipeline, the Occupy movement, Arab Spring, these are all signalers of the emergence of the world's biggest and most profound social movement.
Out of that love and that connection of people to each other, they're going to create a different way to do things.
An economist says that essentially more for you is less for me, but the lover knows that more for you is more for me too.
We live in a time of record-breaking crisis. But it's also a time of record-breaking vision.
Being awake is love. That's what it is. I see that the planet is going to be evolved by a massive uprising of creativity joint.
What if we were able to connect ourselves on a global basis? I think that humans are capable of great things. They're capable of love.
There is no love quite like that. The willingness to put it all on the line for your neighbors, for future generations, for the rest of creation.
Creating a new paradigm as ancient as life.
How could this crisis be framed as a great love story?
Okay, wow. So there is the...
That is what it's all about.
Future.
It is the future.
Love, not money.
Love of money. No, of course not. That's why we're here, to talk about this. It's in the Mint Film Festival this week, the Occupy Love movie, and Glenn, you're in charge of the Mint Film Festival,
well, I found
founder.
And 2011.
Congratulations, that's an amazing festival.
Well, I did it because documentary filmmakers and Toronto musicians needed a vehicle to be made more known to Toronto. And so that's what it stands for. MINT stands for Made in Toronto. And a lot of, I made a mistake actually starting out because we had the nice logo and we kept on going MINT Film Festival, but a lot of people didn't know what MINT stood for. And it stands for Made in Toronto. So when
what
you
did
buy-
What did they think it stood for?
MINT. You know, it's fresh, it's
like
got a
that?
Double meaning.
Oh,
it's very
okay.
refreshing.
Thanks,
and the fact that
I think I'll use that. yeah. So the Mint, and also, you know, I was the executive director of the Toronto Dollar at the time, and I was thinking about ways to promote the Toronto Dollar. I kind of did this as a little project of mine, aside from my Toronto Dollar work. But then it occurred to me that it was something a little bit bigger. And I formed the company. I thought, you know, it would be a good idea to do that because it didn't seem at the time that there was enough resources in the Toronto Dollar to really do that. So I
a little bit ahead of its time, right?
I don't know if we're ahead of our time. I think we're actually a little late. We should have been doing it a while ago.
Okay, interesting.
But at least we're doing it now. We're supporting documentary filmmakers and musicians. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've always wanted to do that. I am a musician. And people know how hard it is to make enough money doing what you love. And I just want to make it easier for people.
Okay.
Hopefully shows like Occupy Love will help.
And let me talk about Velcro Ripper, because that film is done by a Toronto director, and he's amazing. He did that with a number of filmmakers, including Ian McKenzie. And it is just an incredible film. It frames the whole Occupy movement as a love story. So it's a dialogue in which we explore what does that mean for us as a species to contemplate our existence and to figure out how we fit in and how we create a sacred economy rather than an economy that pits us against one another.
Mm-hmm. That's a great idea, sacred economy. Mm-hmm.
So very interesting. Let's just give it a little rundown of the festival because it's a three-day festival. Let's just kind of encapsulate what it's all
well,
about.
It's a three-day event. It starts off at the AGO. Chris is playing with me and Robert Graham. We're going to do a concert, and then we'll do the film by Velcro. And then Charles Eisenstein is coming for the discussion at the end. Both are flying in for the day, and it's going to be an amazing discussion. It's going to kick off the whole weekend, which is basically a festival of... What is it? Of the economy in a sense that we're not really used to thinking of it. Economy for a lot of people means something dry, something not really interesting, but our whole lives hinge around it. Mm-hmm. So what we're doing is re-envisioning that, and it's a very exciting process.
So right now it's really the elephant in the room, right? Because it's something that drives us, but we don't really like to talk about it.
Yeah, a lot of people feel that maybe they don't understand it. And actually, it's simpler than they think. And actually, it's so simple.
They fear it because they fear it, right?
Well, some people say it's a conspiracy to not teach people how real economics works so that they don't ask all the wrong questions.
Yeah. That's true. That's and to some extent, there are people that think that the masses are uneducated and, you know, they don't really belong in the, you know, upper echelons. I don't believe that. I think that everyone needs to know. And if we educate everybody and allow them to participate, it's better for everyone. Mm-hmm. It's not better to hide things.
Well, the thing is, too, especially if that economic system is being managed by people not in everybody's interest, then the people who are refusing or just not wanting to take part in how that works and how it's managed, they're going to be ripped off like we're getting ripped off.
Yeah, well, I think there's two sides. I think a lot of the time, too, it's very easy. I know I found myself doing this because I'm a bit of an activist and I've been involved in a lot of things. And there are some corporations that are doing some pretty not so great things. And but there's also corporations that are interested in helping. And they are run by people. And I think what we need to do is create an environment where everyone can just discuss it and not make people feel bad.
Yeah.
You know? And
I'm not blaming corporations.
I knew you weren't.
Part.
I knew you weren't. But a lot of the time, the dialogue becomes that, and it's a very adversarial way.
Yeah.
Although I am very against, you know, rampant development in the tar sands. You know, I'm personally against that. Right. I think we should conserve that resource, and we're poisoning a lot of water. Mm-hmm. That's very important to get the word out there. But I think we won't actually make any progress if we just frame everybody that we're talking about as the other. We're in it together.
Sure, that's a good point.
Do you feel that if you do take, Glenn, if you feel you take the corporations and you have the good corporations and the not-so-good corporations together in a conversation, do you think it eventually one has to win over the other?
I have no idea what the outcome would be. All I can say is that I would just like to have dialogue.
Okay.
You know?
Okay, you know what? Chris is here, and I heard you guys practicing, and it sounded great.
Awesome.
We'd love to hear a song, and I know you guys are ready to go. Do you want to... Chris, do you want to just maybe introduce what this song is all about?
This is inspired by my work with Buffy St. Marie, who's a humanitarian activist. And I made her last three albums as a producer.
Okay.
I got a Juno for the last one. And while I worked with her, I got in contact with a lot of First Nation people. And I happened to read a speech on, which you can Google it, it's the speech of Chief Seattle. And the time when they handed over the land rights in the 19th century. And one of the things he said on that speech was, man did not weave the web of life, he's merely a strand in it. Whatever he does to the web, he does to himself. So I wrote this song about, I was inspired and touched by that particular thing, which I think is really visionary, because it's exactly what's happening now. With, you know, we're not respecting the planet.
Yeah.
We think we can control nature and be, you know, dominant over everything. And until we turn around and like get back into touch with nature and live with nature and with other people, it's the same devolution is going to happen. You know, I see us in a crossroads now where we can either evolve or devolve, and I think we're in this kind of crisis point, as Irvin Laszlo talks about in his book, The Chaos Point, which everybody should read.
Who wrote
Irvin,
that?
Irvin Laszlo. He's the founding member of the Club of Budapest. He wrote a book called The Chaos Point, and it's really, really interesting.
Well, it's
your cell phone.
When you just said that, it kind of goes right back to our discussion about the corporations, the good, not so good. That seems when you bring those two together, you have those two forces, or it's, you know, those
I think, as Glenn said, dialogue is really important.
Yeah.
As the for and against thing doesn't really work.
Exactly.
It's like the more you put for something, the more resistance you get. And
right.
You get this constant struggle between the dark and the light, whichever you want to call it, or yin and
but
yang.
But you have to bring the two together in order to create that synergy, right?
Yeah. It's not to say that we speak out strongly against injustice, but we have a deeper, broader understanding that whoever we're speaking out against, or that they are actually part of the collective. We are in this together. We are in Spaceship Earth together.
Yeah.
Spaceship Earth. Did you know you live in a spaceship?
Yeah, I knew that.
I knew you did.
Which planet are you from?
We can't tell you.
Or so I'm told.
So that's how this song was born. It was my call to action for what I see going on in the world around me.
Nice.
And I'm going to be playing this song at the festival. So, you know, so
that'd be awesome.
So
okay.
So, we'll give you a little preview now if you want to hear.
Awesome.
It.
Yeah.
Go. Okay to play.
Mm-hmm.
Can I tap on the seat?
Oh yeah, sure.
You can do whatever you want, buddy.
So long, just to give you this song. Hope it won't take too long before we wake up and know the truth. This world was made for all. From the past we have come to the future to learn. From the times we were wrong, we must know now where we belong. This world was made for all. Politicians take the soul of our nations. Politicians do just what they're told. Nobody is listening to our frustrations. We have been sold. Hey! Sky and the wind and the rain. There are things that we just can't buy. This world was made for all. The signs are out there while we still breathe the air. There's a chance if we care. We don't have to go down this road. This world was made for all. Corporations take the soul of our nations. Politicians do just what they're told. Nobody is listening to our frustrations. We have been sold. And time to wake up, wake up.
Come on, everybody.
Time to wake up, wake up.
Time.
That's,
nice.
That sounded great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I hope you're going to check that song out and some other songs we're doing of the same nature.
Okay, so you know what I'd like to do just for a little bit? We don't have a lot of time left, but, you know, let's maybe begin some of that discussion, because this is a weekend of discussion all around what a sacred economy is, what sacred economics is.
Yeah.
What is it, Glenn? I mean, I suspect seen some of these movies already. Yeah. What's your idea? And I know you have some opinions about this.
I think sacred economy really is looking at what's not working and re-envisioning things in a totally new way. I mean, one of the really cool things about Charles Eisenstein coming to Toronto, by the way, it's the first time he's come, but we're really excited about that, is that he is a leading expert in this. Like, he's written this book called Sacred Economy. I haven't read it, actually. I know about it. I'm looking forward to reading it. I'll probably buy a copy. I'm too busy rehearsing and planning the festival to read it right now.
I hear you.
I am, you know, I know what he's talking about because, you know, I had the experience with the Toronto Dollar, and I've, you know, I got a lot of experience in that area. But I think what it's about is about us coming together, figuring out, you know, because things aren't working. You know, there's a lot of people that are, you know, discouraged. I mean, I get upset sometimes because I see people and they think they can't do anything, and I want to run up and hug them. You know, I want to say, you can do it. Like, there's nothing you can't do, you know, like, you can really do something. And that's what we're going to do this week, you know, this weekend, is we're going to show them how, because you got to have the tools. You can't create a new economy if you don't know anything about the economy.
And it's hard to do it when the system is not exactly supporting you.
No, right? Well, that was the whole thing with the Toronto dollar, in fact. You know, Toronto dollar was a great idea, but it was almost like the flow of the current was so strong, it kind of wipes away.
That's actually, it was the Toronto dollar that I thought was ahead of its time. I was referring to the Toronto dollar.
I think all of those movements are. The problem is, I liken it to a stream, and the stream is unsustainable, and the flow is very strong. It's going towards a cliff, and there's some people, like Chris... Sorry. That
speaking from the
really,
heart.
Yeah. That really, you know, stand out. Yeah. You know, they're like a little stone in that stream, and then other people get inspired.
Yes. Yeah. Well, you are one of those people too that stand out.
Chris, do you have any comments as well on the whole idea of sacred economics?
I think we're due for a total reshuffle in the way things are done on this planet. Democracy is, as such, it's not
dead.
It's not dead, but it's corrupted.
Away.
It's corrupted.
Yeah, it needs to be reformed.
For me, a more meritocracy type of system would be better. You know, but I think that what's happening now is this kind of sharing. Is the old barter system that seems to be coming back. We're not going to use money anymore. We help each other according to our own talents. Yes. That could actually work too. You know, nobody really knows what to do. We can see that the old system is not.
But we just don't know where to go from there.
Yeah, so. I want to say one thing, which I feel is really, really important. And excuse me. I think that it's very important for us to work in our immediate environment. In other words,
local.
I see like people out there trying to save the world, and then their kids are left like just at home and on the streets and on drugs and stuff. You know, I know a lot of people like that. And I think that we have to get the immediate environment of our own family and our own self in order to radiate out and change the world. I don't think we can. Gandhi said, "Be the change you want to make in the world," and that's one of my favorite sayings, because it's true.
Mine too.
The world is a mirror. It reflects your inner world. It's reflected in the outside world, what you see. So I feel everybody can do something. There's not something, oh, it's hopeless, we can't do anything.
No.
We can all do something. We can change right now. Like, we can go and turn that light off over there. Yeah. We don't need it, so turn it off, you know.
Yeah.
Just small stuff, you know, to save resources, etc.
Well, I guess one thing people can do, maybe if they don't know what to do, is go to the film festival. That starts this Friday.
Yeah,
Now, Glenn, what's the best way for them to get more information or get tickets
well, go
or
to
find
the
out?
Film Festival website. It's pretty easy.
www.mintfffilmfestival.org.
And on that, you'll see a write-up of the events. You can click on tickets and buy tickets right away. You've heard a little bit about it, but there's a lot more information on the website. And the real deal is the three-day pass, which is $71, which is unbelievable, because you get, almost like a very intimate setting with Charles on Sunday. It's a catered lunch. You get this concert, you know, extravaganza we got on Friday, you know, discussion, and also a talk at UFT of 400 people. So it's fabulous, you know. And if you can, if you're available, I'd say go for it. If you can't, then the two-day pass is, Saturday and Sunday. Or you can just go to the individual events. Whatever, even if you just go to one event, it's going to be transformative.
Okay,
wow, looks
awesome.
Really, really, really good.
Well, thanks for coming in today. And
thank you, buddy, for getting me on
here. Thank you guys for doing this.
Thanks for being part of it.
Yeah, well, that's why we're here, Hugh. You are a community builder.
Well, I'm doing my best.
Thanks, like we
Glenn.
All are.
Thank you, Glenn. And great to meet you, Chris.
Yeah,
and
you too.
Actually, we got a video of your music right now.
Oh, yes, a song from my last album, Freedom.
And do you want to give out your website?
Just
for people who want to.
Well, I've got two under construction. but they've got stuff on them. It's Chris Birkett. So it's BIRKETT, chrisburkett.net, and .ca is my second site.
Okay.
Welcome to Canada.
Canadian, yeah, exactly.
Welcome.
I'm here to stay.
Absolutely. You're here to stay. I like that.
I love Canada.
Can't stay away from our winters.
So, Not yet. Not until the pole shift. Then Newfoundland will have the best climate in North America.
We're all going to Newfoundland.
I know that. That's why I came here.
Okay, so here's a video from Chris, and we're going to come back with Laurie Kennedy and Laureen Soro talking about the Wellness Business Summit. As the lunch continues, we'll be right back. We're back here on the show, and we have Laurie Kennedy and Laureen Soro here. Laureen is the founder of the Wellness Business Summit that's coming up in March.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Sounds Laurie?
Wonderful.
Yes. So let's find out what this is all about.
So the Wellness Business Summit is being held March 23rd at the Ontario Science Centre, and it's a one-day event that is created specifically for alternative wellness practitioners that's going to be revealing the key strategies, systems, and tactics that they need to either start up or grow their wellness-based business.
Okay, and what does that include, wellness-based business? Because I'm thinking about all kinds of things, everywhere from EFT to
reflexology, massage therapy.
Yeah.
So anyone who is an alternative wellness practitioner, and yes, that term is really broad. So anyone from a personal trainer to a Pilates instructor to a yoga instructor to
meditation?
A naturopath. Yeah, meditation, Reiki. Anyone who's pretty much not an MD is invited to come and join us for the day to learn practical, easy to implement business strategies that aren't taught really in any university course or certification course or diploma level program. None of this stuff that's happening now online, it's being taught So we want to bring these people together and really teach them what's working.
Okay, now is it a different, are there different business techniques than another kind of business would have to think about?
A little bit, because some of the alternative wellness practitioners are regulated. And so they have a very strict guidelines that they have to follow. For example, they can't use before and after photos like a personal trainer could. Mm-hmm. So they do have we have to plan a strategy a little bit differently for the regulated professions. But business is business, marketing is marketing. Mm-hmm. It's not being taught. And so the wellness practitioners are having a hard time keeping up in the competitive wellness world.
Okay, so we also have Laureen here. And Laureen, what's your, how did you come to be involved in this worthwhile project?
Well, Laurie and I both sit on the board for the Canadian Association of Holistic Nutrition Professionals, which is commonly called CANPRO. And so we wanted to help Laurie because our members are the people that she's talking about.
Okay.
They are all holistic nutritionists. We run a board certification program that we give them after they graduate from school.
Okay.
But they still need to know how to market themselves and how to promote themselves in order to get a sustainable living. So it's a value to our members as well as all the other wellness practitioners.
So really starting, you perceive the need with your membership, and then, of course, that same need is also shared by other people that aren't necessarily your members.
Yeah.
Okay. What are some of the main issues that your membership and the other people that are going to benefit from this conference are facing right now?
I think they're facing a couple of things. One, they're not being taught really practical elements that drive a business. So how to generate profit, what are the steps that they need to do, the fundamentals that they need to create in order to have a solid business foundation, a platform from which they can grow and sustain a financially viable private practice. Mm-hmm. And so little things from where to spend your money on a website, how to use Facebook to actually drive revenue, mm-hmm. How to create a sales funnel mm-hmm. so that you can take interested prospects and convert them to clients and keep them long term, understanding the lifetime value of a client, understanding how to use email marketing techniques, and all of these things that are now becoming so popular in the online space, in addition to helping you grow the offline space. These are the key elements that a lot of practitioners are struggling with, that they don't know where to start, where to begin. They feel overwhelmed.
Well, it's a whole nother business in and of itself, though.
Yeah.
I mean, it's one thing to know health and nutrition. It's another thing to understand business.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So what is your background? Is it more nutrition, or is it sounds like you have a marketing or a business background?
I actually have no business, formal business training. So I've just recently, in the last couple of years, become very obsessed with it. And my formal training is as a registered holistic nutritionist, but I very quickly learned that you can be very well educated, have many letters after your name, but if you don't understand how to market yourself and promote yourself and how to be a business person first, you can have all the information and education and passion in the world, you're not going to be able to get clients and sustain a financially viable practice.
You know, it's interesting because you mentioned, I'm sure if an MD wanted to come to the conference,
absolutely,
they're welcome to come. Right?
Anyone is welcome to come.
But it's just interesting that here you guys are, alternative health practitioners, and we're seeing, and especially in this province, where the establishment medical system, i.e. the hospitals, the doctors, the budgets are going through the roof. They're saying it's going to be taking an ever larger portion of the entire provincial budget.
Mm-hmm. And service is tanking on top of
that. And service is tanking, and people are getting injured in many cases by the medical system.
Yes.
But I mean, it's like, and something's got to, do you want to talk about that? I mean,
no,
you don't have to.
Not at all.
I think people out there all have their own stories to tell.
Absolutely. And I think that's one of the reasons that the Wellness Business Summit has come up, and it's gained so much popularity, in addition to CANPRO supporting it and the Canadian School of Natural Nutrition sponsoring it, and another food company called UB Livin' Smart is sponsoring it as well. And we have amazing vendors and all kinds of people, because the passion behind it really is to educate wellness practitioners to be able to have these businesses to support the medical community. And that's really the truth of it, for the exact reason that you just said, is that we're divided right now and we need to be united, because at the end of the day, it's the Canadian population. It's the everyday people who really need the support, and they're not always getting it from their medical doctors, so they look for alternative practitioners. And what we're trying to do with the summit is to give the tools, the business tools, the confidence, and the experience that we've had, and help them to grow their businesses so that we can all rise up together and truthfully just support the everyday person.
It sounds to me like, because we all know that the Medicare system is headed for, it's going to break at some point, right?
Rocky road.
And I know that there are people talking, at least, about trying to reform it, but, like so many things, it probably just has to die, and then the new system has to be in place to help people when that happens. And it sounds like you guys are really, at a grassroots level, really trying to put together, or it's at least an attempt to put a new system together that can be there when the other system collapses.
Go ahead.
Well, it was funny, while I was listening to your earlier segment, and they were talking about the economy and the new model for the economy, and this is the same situation.
I was just thinking the same thing, bringing
situation.
The opposing forces together to kind of discuss, to have a dialogue, and to start working together.
And so much money can be saved.
Absolutely. Rather than seeing each other as enemies, let's look at each other as allies and go from there.
Exactly. And they are open. And despite what some people might think, they actually are.
Really? See, I would have thought they weren't. I'm one of those people who thought, oh, I don't think that the medical establishment is...
They just have to hear it said a certain way that speaks to their language. Yeah, it's not that hard. They really are quite open.
Well, that's good. That's great to hear.
Okay, so let's talk specifically about some of the events. I know you have a keynote speaker.
Yep. So Dr. Natasha Turner... leading naturopathic doctors in North America right now, and so she's going to be heading up the keynote address along with Dean Parks, who's the president of Preferred Nutrition, and Jenna Webb, who is the founder of Joga with Jenna, and Cable McElderry, who's the founder of Profitable Personal Trainer, and myself, Lori Kennedy, in association with CanPro. And so we're having presentations and speakers give really practical advice. It's not the fluff sort of motivational, you can do it, rah-rah. It's go home, write this way, use these words, use this subject line. This is how you create a funnel, so that the practitioners attending the summit can leave, literally improve their business within the next 7 days.
Now, how does it work?
Wow.
Are there going to be different seminars that people can sign up for, or is it going to be one program that everybody is going to
day.
Be... Okay.
Yeah.
So people aren't going to miss anything, or they're going to get everything if they go.
Yeah. It's Saturday, March 23rd. You can purchase tickets at www.wellnessbusinesssummit.com.
Okay.
And they can purchase a ticket.
Yeah.
We've actually extended the early bird, and there's an optional organic lunch being created by Fuel Nutrition. And yeah, they'll come for the whole day. They'll get to network with like-minded people, which is always so nice. And learn from industry leaders who have had success that most of the attendees, I assume, are striving to achieve.
Awesome. So what time does it start?
It starts at 8:30, registration opens.
Okay.
And we're going to go until about 6. So it's
a long day.
It's a long learning day, but we are providing, lunch is optional, and we have some snacks, and we have amazing food.
How many people are you expecting to come through there? It sounds like it's going to be a big, packed day.
Yeah, there's going to be over 200 people attending the day.
Which is a small number compared to the number of practitioners there are in Toronto.
Absolutely,
right?
Yeah.
So
this is your first year, though,
this
correct?
This is the first year.
Okay. Yeah, so hopefully everyone will get a chance to tell their fellow practitioners next year, because it's something that really has to continue.
Absolutely.
And even some of the things you mentioned, like the Facebook, I mean, you don't learn that at business school.
No.
And the environment is changing constantly. So by doing it on a regular basis, you'll have the opportunity to keep on top of what's happening, right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. What else? Is there anything else that we need to know about this? I mean, it sounds like an awesome opportunity for people in this field.
Is there anything else?
Well, it's also the other practitioners can meet the other practitioners for referral purposes, too.
Yeah.
So that's an important element that isn't happening right now, that we don't refer to
networking.
Each other as much as we could because we don't know each other. Mm-hmm. So it's a great opportunity for all the different practitioners to come together.
So bring your business cards, make sure.
Now, I just maybe one last question, but how does the public, because the public, you know, sometimes people perceive the public as not really being up to date with the latest and the greatest alternatives that are available
right.
to them. How are you guys finding the public's acceptance of alternative health?
It's amazing, actually, because I've been around a long time. I started out in the organic industry in 1989. I am shocked at how easy it is to find almost every person I speak to knows something about alternative medicine now mm-hmm. today.
It's a real disadvantage, though, I would think, that because it's not covered by OHIP, you tend to lose people.
It's a challenge.
That's
sure.
actually one of the things we're going to be talking about. Because I actually just got that question last night from a practitioner who was asking about some business advice. And so the question was, how do you get someone to opt in or to, you know, subscribe to your service when it's not covered by OHIP or insurance? And so one of the things we'll be teaching is how to really hit those emotional hotspots with these clients to get them to know, like, and trust you mm-hmm. so that it's not an option. I mean, if you think about the amount of money people pay for silly things mm-hmm. because they feel that emotional desire to have it. Mm-hmm. So again, it just goes back to understanding how to market yourself, really, to get them to buy into what you have.
So instead of buying that extra pair of shoes that you really don't need and have room for in
right.
your closet.
Exactly. Put your health before your footwear.
And people need to take responsibility for their own health, right? I think
yes.
the days of saying, whatever my doctor
yeah.
wants, I'll do whatever the doctor
right.
wants, right?
I mean, with all due respect to the medical industry, a lot of them are not as healthy as they should be.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the alternative wellness practitioners, you know, step up as we try, for the most part, we're still human, to practice what we preach. And so just going back to what you asked before in terms of how open is the public to it, there's actually a great website that just recently launched called asknaturalhealth.ca, and they're our media partner actually for the summit. And so what the website does is it matches the public. It's a great platform. It matches the public with wellness practitioners in Canada across 13 different disciplines. So you can actually ask questions to the practitioners mm-hmm. and get to know them before you go and visit them. So
nice.
Yeah, so that's a really great way to find someone in your local area, other than just Googling, you know, naturopathic doctor. Mm-hmm. This is a really much more personal way. But yeah, the public is, there's a shift. People are going to their, you know, doctors and then seeing what else is out there.
Wow.
Okay, and now how do people sign up or get tickets or whatever they need to do?
So they can visit www.wellnessbusinesssummit.com.
Okay.
And they can go right on that website and they can buy their tickets.
Should we tell them how much those tickets are?
Those tickets are $87 plus HST for the early bird and $67 if you're a student.
Okay.
And how long is that early bird open?
We're going to keep it open
extended?
For another 7 days.
Okay.
We've
okay.
extended it.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Beautiful.
Well, it
wow.
sounds like a
good
much
luck.
Needed.
Yeah.
Project.
Yeah, and I suspect this is the first of many.
Thank you.
Yeah, so thanks for coming on, guys. Okay, so we're going to play a little video now and get ready for Kreskin is coming up.
Okay.
And you can't believe it, but it's
no,
true.
I don't believe it.
Well, we're going to, okay, so I have a few different videos. Let's see, you know, the Russians, they did an alien autopsy
video
too.
Video Kreskin.
Well, you know, everybody knows Kreskin.
Okay, that's true.
Anyway, the Russians did an alien autopsy. We have video. We're going to watch it right now, and then we'll come back with Kreskin.
You're going to see Hugh's face if it's an alien autopsy.
Okay, we're back on the show here. And can we turn the... Thanks, Andy. We've got the amazing Kreskin.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me clearly now?
Perfect, Kreskin. It's great to have you here on the show.
Oh, my
What was the problem, folks? I don't know.
You know what? It was probably, maybe it's some psychic vibe.
I was going to say, can the viewers hear us now? The people
listening? Yeah, we're perfect.
Well, you know what I should say? What should be said to me? How come I didn't know this was going to happen?
Kreskin, I'm a huge fan.
Well, that's great. That's great. It's great. It's good to be. This is live, and you know, you're in Toronto, are you?
Yes, we are.
Where are you?
I'm actually out of New Jersey, but I spend an awful lot of time in Canada. Canada's my second home. You got to understand that. You know that. Huh?
You know, Kreskin.
I grew up watching you.
Kreskin, I was talking to a friend of yours. James B. He says you guys are good friends.
All right, and tell me what was going on with
James
Mr. B.
He's having his 50th birthday party this year. Anyway,
he's a very well-known musical artist in
so,
Toronto.
So yeah, he says,
"Oh, yes, just now I know who you mean." Yeah, and you send him my very best regards and my very best thoughts. And I'll tell you one thing, the next time we talk, and I foresee this, we won't have to worry about this because I'll be with you in person. We'll do it on the air in person.
That would be so.
Wouldn't that be good?
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. Thanks for that'll be awesome. Looking forward to it. But let's talk about 2013 right now. Let's use that as a start because you made some predictions about 2013, Kreskin. We'd love to talk about it because we're concerned. We want things to go well for people. And what have you seen?
Well, you know, by the way, I have written this is my 19th book. I am like on cloud nine about this. It's called Conversations with Kreskin. And people, folks, if it's not in your bookstores, you can go on the internet, go on my webpage, amazingkreskin.com, or go on amazon.com or Barnes & Noble's, what have you. It's my 19th book, and I wrote about my work and behind the scenes, what has happened to me through the years, and part of the, what, by the way, I'll tell you what's neat about this. In the middle of the book, and I'm like a kid about this. I got to tell you, I'm like a child. In the middle of the book, believe it or not, Joe St. Pierre, who's a very famous cartoonist, has done 8 pages in the form of a cartoon of the first incident that happened in my life that was the turning point that made me realize at 9 years old that I was going to spend my life reading minds. So you can imagine how excited I am about the book right now. But as far as the future is concerned, I'll tell you there were a couple of significant turning points. Here in the States, as you folks know, we had an election last fall in November. And I, on a late night show, have you folks heard of the Jimmy Fallon show? It's on NBC in the States called Jimmy Fallon.
Yes, we have.
And I, a year and 4 months before the election, which was last November, I wrote out what I thought would be the results of the election. I decided I'd see if I can pick which party was going to win. Well, I did something else that I did not tell anybody about. I attempted to write down who I thought would be running on the Republican ticket. And last July, when I wrote this, and we showed a chart in November, when I wrote this a year ago, July, 1 year and 4 months before the election, nobody knew who was going to run on the Republican ticket. There were like 21 names. One was Sarah Palin and so forth. The bottom line is, when I opened my prediction, and I had 4 copies of them to different sources, they brought on 3 safes, each of whom had my predictions in it. I did predict the election, but I also said I failed in naming who the Republicans would pick in running for the president. The man I wrote down was a man by the name of Paul Ryan, and the reason it got so much excitement is when Romney was finally picked to run for the Republican ticket, he picked a person out of obscurity to run as vice president. It was Paul Ryan. And everybody wonders, how in God's name did I pick a name that nobody even thought about or heard about? And I'm going to tell all of you folks who watched me through the years, that man, I remember seeing his name in print when I was trying to decide who was going to run for Republican ticket. And I went jogging the night before. I run an hour every night between 4 and 5 in the morning. I'm an avid jogger. And when I was running, the name Paul Ryan kept coming into my head over and over. I couldn't get it out of my mind. I thought, hey, I'm pretty sure I predicted the election, which party would win. Let me take a shot at the Republican thing, and that's how I ended up naming the vice president candidate.
Wow.
So it's, and you know, everybody's asking me, what made me, how did I do that? What happened in here? And I want to tell all of you folks who've watched me through these years, I can't give you an answer. I really can't. It is the same thing that happened some years ago on something I really talk, I very rarely talk about. But in 2001, I was asked to appear on CNN on New Year's Day and predict the what I thought was going to happen for that particular year. And in the middle of my comment, I suddenly interrupted, and I've never watched this again. I can't watch this. We have copies of it. I won't look at it. I suddenly interrupted and said, I don't know why the hell I'm saying this, but I have a feeling here in New York in September of this year, there's going to be a disaster involving two airlines. Well, 2 days after 9/11, 2 days after that date, my life was changed. I spent a week with the FBI. I spent time with the CIA, and they kept saying, what made you say this? How would you, 9 months ahead of time, have said something like this? Of course, 9/11 was the day that the two airlines crashed into the buildings here in the city. Some of these things I really can't explain, but at the same time, you know what? I'm not a fortune teller. I pick up, as I travel the world, feelings I have in people, and it enables me to project into the future like a weatherman. You know, in Toronto, whatever the city, looks at the weather today and kind of projects in the future. And something inside me enables me to do some of this, which is, by the way, how a few weeks ago I predicted the Super Bowl 4 days before the game took place. And I predicted that the Ravens would win, the 49ers would be the losers. And I said the Ravens' score would be 34. And their score was exactly 34. So my work's been kind of dramatic, I got to tell you.
Okay, well, Kreskin, I mean, wow. I really hope, if you've been looking at what's going to be happening this year, like, you know, politically, every way, that you don't have any bad news to report. But we, regardless of whether it's good or bad news, what is the news? What do we have to look forward to this year or in the near future?
Well, I want to say something to all of you that are students out there. Some of you may be home now. Some of you may be looking and listening to this on the internet or what have you. Students in Canada and students in the United States, because everyone tells me, of all the things I've talked about, the future of our lifestyle, this is probably one of the most important things they could have ever heard of. And students at college, I've done over 1,000 college shows. Not long ago was the University of in Manitoba, the university there, but I've done over 1,000 college shows here in North America. Let me tell you folks, this is not a warning. This is the facts of life. For the first time in history, for the first time in the history of mankind, since 10 years ago, it's going to be very different when you apply for a job. It's going to be something that no person ever had before you did or students 10 years ago. Because now when you go for a job, let me tell you the picture of it, and I'll explain it in a different way by giving you an incident that happened last year here in the United States. We had a march on Wall Street. It was a group of students, and you all saw it in Canada, and everybody has a right to protest. Hey, That's what the free world is based on. If they do things that are wrong, if they break things or do things that are immoral, that's different. But the march on Wall Street was perfectly fine, except, and let me tell you this, as far away as Germany, except today, when you apply for a job, and there are more of you than there are jobs, because in the United States, there are more people than there are jobs, there's one extra aspect that's taken into consideration, the internet. And all the CEOs who will deny it if they're interviewed will assign their people, all right, we've got these six people, they all got good marks at school, go on the internet. And what do they find on the internet? every single solitary piece of information that exists about that human being from age one on to the present time. Never in the history of mankind could I ever say that there are no secrets left, but now everything is there. So in a college, and we all did crazy things. I was performing already by then, but you're at a fraternity affair and you do some, you know, some crazy thing and a friend of yours photographs it. That picture is very likely to come up 6-7 years later when you no longer have that friend, but he may have sent it to some other friends on the internet. So this is a very, very different world. It's a different world where our past responsibilities catch up with us. But you know something? In Germany, they tried to outlaw this. They tried to pass a law that said, when you hire someone, you can't look in the internet. And what did the CEO say? They said this. You open the internet, you opened it to everyone, it will never close again. And this is a sign, this is something I want to alert all of you listening in, because college students say to me, Kreskin, nobody has ever told us this. So it's a piece of information that you can work with. The other thing that's going to happen, I think, and it's on the good side, is that people are going to start sitting at home around a kitchen table and drinking a glass of beer or having a glass of wine or a cup of soda or 7-Up or eating and touching each other. Why do I say touching each other? Because in recent years, we've forgotten how to do this. There are people who do all their communication on the internet and press buttons. You show me. Show me a person who has 200 friends on the internet, and I will show you a very lonely person. Part of life is touching each other. Whether we're in love, whether we're pissed off, whether we're angry, it's communicating directly. And we're starting to lose a word in the United States and Canada that's very important. That word is neighborhood, where little Johnny can run out of the house and get lost running down the street. And Mrs. So-and-so living way down there says, hey, you get your ass back there, or I'm going to tell your mommy, and that person goes back. That is going to come back. And in Canada, the writers and the reporters are calling it Kreskin's dining room touching. That's what I'm looking forward to seeing in the future. You understand what I mean, folks?
I totally understand, Kreskin, but I just, how is it going to happen? Because we see what is happening. I had a discussion with my cousin, and we grew up just around the corner from each other, and it was like that. It was like that when we grew up, and now he lives in a development in a Toronto suburb, and he says it's totally not like that. You don't even talk to your neighbors. How is it going to change back to that?
It's going to change back to when people like what you've just said and people like yours truly are telling more and more individuals, you got to go out and take a walk. You got to walk down the street and say hello to a few people here and there. And do yourself a favor. It hasn't been done for years. Leave anonymous notes without signing it. Leave it in the door of a neighbor that lives across the hall. Not anything provocative. It might say, think a good day. I think it's going to be good. Or, you know, I have a feeling that some good things are going to happen today. Leave those notes along the way. I'm going to tell you something, because I've advised this privately to fraternity groups I've met with and others. They say to me, you know, Kreskin, we thought this was kind of silly. Who's going to ever find out who wrote this note? A week or so later, I bump into someone, and someone said to me, hey, you know, I got the damnedest note on the face of the earth. The guy, whoever this person, I don't know if it's a man or woman, they said, why don't you smile? You'll infect someone else. And the guy said, I'm the person that wrote it. Everything we do can touch someone else, and that can be the beginning. And oh, by the way, there's one other aspect. We're sharing this earth. All of you listening in, you're worried about your kids. You're worried about them communicating with the real world. Get a pet. Get a pet cat. Get a pet dog. Cats are more popular in Canada and the United States in apartment buildings because they're easier to take care of. Let me tell you something about an animal. They don't betray people. And let me tell you something why you never hear of a dog being anything but a close friend. Because dogs wag their tails, not their tongues.
You know, Kreskin, you actually, I don't know if you read my mind or I read yours, but I was going to say another way to get in touch with your community, a very dear friend of mine, in her area, everybody has dogs. And so what they have is a street party for all the dog owners, and they all go to the park and they all party together. And
I would be at that park. I would be at that park. Because, you know, you got to understand something about animals. They don't betray people.
Yes.
And the bonding that, yes, I'm not home that much because I'm traveling constantly around the world. But friends of mine, one friend of mine and his wife, who I've known since we were kids, he takes the dog to a park where other dogs come and meet. But you know what happens? As these dogs frolic together and run together and so forth, guess who's part of them? The people the dogs have brought.
Absolutely.
Because by the way, you have to understand, I have three cats here. And if I didn't travel, I have dogs as well. I have three cats. They own the house. I mean, I rent it from them and I take care of them and what have you. But they pretty much see what's going on. I love animals. If I didn't travel, God is my judge. If I didn't travel, I would have probably five or six dogs. I'd have four or five cats. I'd also have a pig, like George Clooney, because pigs are, and Johnny Carson used to say this all the time, they're probably the most intelligent of all the animal world. They can be very, very loyal to you.
And extremely sensitive. So next time you have bacon, Hugh.
Can I tell you something? I got to tell you quick, because everyone here knows this. And when I come home, I walk into the family room, and I did have four cats, but I lost Miss Kitty. She passed away in my arms. And but at the same time, I walk into the family room, and Bugsy, who is around 13 years old, he's ferocious. He's a big, heavy, lovable a gray and white cat. And he jumps on my lap and puts his head here. And now listen to this. I kiss him on the back of the head, and he immediately licks me back. Every time I kiss him, he licks me back. The veterinarian says, you know, I think Bugsy thinks he's a dog, but he's good as a cat. When I come on in person, and I want to warn all the viewers right now, I gotta warn, when I come on in person, I'll probably read the thoughts of one or two of you. Oh my God, this should be interesting, right?
Well, okay, so I think that he would be a lot more interesting for you to read.
You would
not myself.
No.
Now, can I say this about the two of you? I get good vibrations, folks. All of you listening in, as far, and they can't stop me from saying this. These two folks I'm listening, they're good folks. They're flaky, but they're good folks, and those are the only interest.
Oh well, thank you so much.
I think you're picking that up from Sandra Kreskin.
Sandra, is that true? But you know what? My picture's at home, and this is so neat. I'm being interviewed, and we can see each other. And I always say this about my friends. My picture's at home. They're on the wall. But they're like this.
Twisted.
Yeah, yeah.
Just slightly.
So are you saying you're a flake too? Are you speaking from one flake to another?
I started my career reading comic books when I was 5 years old, and that's how I pretty much knew what I was going to do for a living, because I had a comic hero that his name was Mandrake, and his name was Mandrake the Magician, but he really wasn't a magician. He had hypnotic abilities, and he was able to read people's thoughts. And he was able to influence people hypnotically. And I knew that comic was the turning point in my life. And I still have that one comic. And I knew that I was going to model my life after him. And then, some 30 years later, one of the most important incidents of my entire life took place to me. By then, I was known, and people knew who I was and what have you. And there was a conference in New York City at Sardi's restaurant, a very famous show business restaurant. And it was professors from a university and some graduate students, mm-hmm. a few hundred. And they were going to interview a man that was a legend in the comic book field. He had started writing comics in 1935, and his name was Lee Falk. And Lee Falk created two comics. One was Mandrake, and one was The Phantom. In both comics, even in the Second World War in Australia, Mandrake was a number one comic, and The Phantom, who's been made into movies, was a comic. Mandrake, by the way, is being done prepared for a movie right now, being prepared for a motion picture here in the States. But they were going to interview him, and they heard that his comic had a great influence on me. So they said, Kreskin, would you come to this conference? We are going to be questioning Mr. Falk. And I arrived there early, and I said hello to Lee Falk, and he evidently knew who I was and what have you. But the incredible moment was, in the hours that went by, in the middle of one of Lee Falk's comments about his comics, he turned to the audience and said, I want you to know, in all the years I've been writing Mandrake, the person who's come closest in real life to being exactly my cartoon character is Kreskin. Can you imagine what thrill that was in my life?
Wow.
I will never forget that moment. It's one of the moments of... You have an audience there! Boy, I gotta...
Yes,
I gotta,
you do!
Gotta, I have to come there in person. That I foresee.
Okay.
Listen, I'm sorry.
Sorry, I know it's kind of tough with the Skype here, Kreskin, but we just got a couple more minutes, but I wanted to just ask you again about a couple other issues that are important. I wanted to ask you about, you know, the whole issue of drugs and crime and people's safety in their homes.
I'll tell you something about the drug situation. I mean, I've never been involved in drugs. Thank God. It's a blessing and what have you. But if you see right now, so many celebrities, and they don't have to be just in show business, they can be in public life and so forth, there have been the victim of drugs. The tragedy of drugs is that in the States, and I can't say the same of Canada, if you knew the success of the rehabilitation in the drug, the legitimate drug treatment centers in the United States, it is so small, it is scary. It is a very, very difficult thing to overcome the use of drugs. I happen to feel, and this has left me unpopular with a lot of politicians, and by the way, folks, because I predicted elections in Canada in the past and what have you, and I've made predictions here, as I said, this past year, I don't want anyone to think that I'm against politicians. I sometimes wish that most of them had been the Titanic, but that's for other reasons. However, I would like to see, I think the answer is going to have to be in some way that drugs be legalized. Not that I'm encouraging it, because there would have to be some kind of control and prescriptions involved, because it would take the profit out of drugs. There's too much profit involved. And folks, all of you, listen to me. I'm old enough to be able to say this very blatantly. You could not have the sale and success of drugs in cities, like cities here in the United States and what have you, if you didn't have certain people on the payroll. In the days of prohibition, do you think that illegal liquor was being sold all over the place simply because the underworld was being able to keep out of the telescope of the authorities? Are you getting my message? Do you hear what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree with you 100%.
We need to legalize it to get the profit out of it. And by the way, I will talk to you. My time has gone by, but I will mention one more thing about crime. Crime is an issue. It has been it's an issue in the States. It's an issue in the free world. And we have to support our law enforcement people. My brother was a policeman 18 years. It's not an easy thing to be a policeman today, because you not only have to be a policeman, you got to be a psychologist, you got to be a lawyer, and you got to be able to touch somebody and protect yourself if you touch somebody on the shoulder. It's a difficult time, so we have to be supportive of them, but I also have to imbue in our students a feeling of absolute responsibility. We are responsible for what we do. And if we're not responsible for what we do, we can't blame someone else. We can't blame the blame game. Folks, all of you listening in the United States, we're getting a growing sense of entitlement, which something is due us. The government has to give us this. The politicians have to give us this and what have you. If we don't succeed here, this has got to be done for us. People who are in trouble have to be helped. But the other thing to remember is this. And this is one of the most important messages I can give to students, whether they're 12 years old or whether they're 7 years old. We learn more from failures than we do from successes. Make them pay off by rising above them and saying, I'm going to get my ass in order and make something work anyway. Okay, guys.
Wow. Kreskin, that's awesome. Thanks for coming on the show. We look forward to meeting you in person. Now, the book you mentioned, is there a website or something where people can go and order that?
Go on amazingkreskin.com. You'll find out exactly how to order it, and it's the conversation with Kreskin. You can go on my webpage, amazingkreskin.com, and just as you put the, you'll know who signed it by the conversations with Kreskin. Can you guess who wrote the book? You can figure that out. Listen, folks, I love talking to you, and let me just say this, in the spirit of broadcasting, I'm not going to say goodbye. Let's just say to be continued. Okay.
Awesome. Okay. You are amazing.
Awesome.
Thank you.
You did it.
That is so awesome. Okay.
Wow. Sounds like I grew up with him. Oh my God.
That's because you only got two stations in Sudbury.
And one I couldn't understand because it was French.
Okay. Well,
so
okay.
I really
there
only
you
got
go.
One.
So, yes. And
oh
so.
Oh my God. That was amazing. What a treat for me. I'm going to be high all day now.
Of course,
Thank
it's
you,
amazing.
Thank you. That was amazing.
Okay. Listen, we got the show is getting bigger and bigger. We got Adam Jang coming on still. Lisa Bailey is here, and Val and Max, of course, are here.
Of course.
Since Kreskin was talking about the Super Bowl, I've got a little bit of a video here. Apparently, the Illuminati was all over that Super Bowl.
Really?
So let's watch this video. We're going to come back with one of our next guests as Liquid
Whoever
Lunch continues. We'll be right back.
I'm Melissa Melton reporting for InfoWars Nightly News. The day after the Super Bowl, the top story on Yahoo.com was, did Beyonce flash an Illuminati sign? Next to a picture of Beyonce making a pyramid hand symbol, the article goes on to say, according to legend, the Illuminati are a tiny super secret cabal of influential individuals who have shaped the course of world events. So it makes perfect sense that Beyonce would flash their triangle sign to one of the largest viewing audiences in human history. What better way to preserve a secret? That's a definite possibility. Founded by Bavarian professor of law Adam Weishaupt in 1776, the Illuminati is considered the most notorious secret society, a sect bent on manipulating reality and dominating through a world government. These so-called illuminated ones have been referred to by some as Satan's elite, whom they worship. Their symbol is a pyramid to illustrate the idea of a top-down societal control system, and the pyramid features an all-seeing eye, or the eye of Lucifer. InfoWars has reported extensively on the history of the Illuminati, their birthplace, their prevalence in popular culture, music, movies, and their intent to dominate the world. While the article's language seems to sarcastically play off Beyonce's hand gestures, no big deal. This isn't the first time we've seen questionable symbolism at the Super Bowl.
Look at these screenshots we've got from last night's Super Bowl performance by Madonna, and then you can also Google image search for yourself and type in Baphomet. And of course, we see that Madonna is dressed up as Baphomet. She's sitting on the throne of Baphomet. She's got the horns. Later on, she's got the hand gestures of Baphomet. And this is the idol that the American people during Super Bowl halftime show are being told to worship. So who's Baphomet? Baphomet is an idol used by Satanists to represent the devil.
This also isn't the first time we've seen questionable symbolism from Beyonce. The pagan deity Baphomet, a figure revived in the 19th century as an idol for Satan worship, has been prominently featured in her videos and album artwork, and she even wears a Baphomet ring. And Beyonce isn't the only music star by far who's been called out for having hidden symbolism in her videos. The Yahoo article claims that Beyonce is merely supporting her husband's record label. But if this symbol is a diamond and not a pyramid, why are he, Beyonce, and other stars seen looking through it with one eye? In addition, let's analyze this shirt sold under Jay-Z's clothing label. It again depicts the pyramid hand symbol with the all-seeing eye atop it, and 13 rays of light coming out of the sides, encircled by a serpent and other smaller symbols with the tagline, "Masters of the Craft" at the bottom. Jay-Z has also had some interesting critiques of hidden messages in his music as well.
Jay-Z, H to the Izzo, V to the Izze, Jehovah God, that's what he calls himself. We just happened to come across a very disturbing song by Brother Jay-Z and has a backwards message in it, and we had to reverse the song and play the song backwards.
six, six, six. Murder, murder, Jesus.
And the rapper has gone on record wondering why people have linked him to devil worship and the Illuminati. When asked by radio personality Angie Martinez if these rumors of deliberately adding images to his videos were true, Jay-Z responded, "No, never done that before. Why would I do that? That's retarded." But here's a clip of another interview where Jay-Z actually admits he hides messages in his music.
And then I start doing, these different, hidden messages in the music. You know, just as a, that replaced, you know, the technical aspect of it. And then it's just, you know, evolved from there.
The Super Bowl aside, we've seen other curious eye symbolism at major events. At the one-year anniversary of 9/11, the band marched out onto Ground Zero in what appeared to be an all-seeing eye formation. Are all of these mere coincidences? Many people ask, if the Illuminati is such a super secret cabal and they're so devious, why are they openly hiding their symbols in plain sight? In his book, Secret Societies and Psychological Warfare, Michael Hoffman II calls this revelation of the method, or advertising one's power openly to amplify it, gloating and flaunting the idea that resistance is futile before an unsuspecting public. Are all of these established Illuminati symbols supposed to acclimate people subconsciously to a darker agenda? Or are we really supposed to believe that all-seeing eyes and pyramids and Baphomet costumes are going to be the new theme for the Super Bowl every year? And what is the average person supposed to think about this continuous symbolism inundation? Or is the truth that they're not supposed to think at all, but just go along with their regularly scheduled programming? I mean, how many coincidences can you have before it's not a coincidence anymore? These are overt messages of elite domination by a covert group parading a pageant of mass conditioning before the public in a culture dominated by television at a sporting event watched by millions every year, and many do not even realize what's happening. If it doesn't mean anything, why is it there? For InfoWars Nightly News, I'm Melissa Melton.
And she's a photographer. And Lisa, great to have you on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Now, I've heard a lot about you, but I guess you're a photographer, and you had a big exhibit for Black History Month.
Yes, it's still going on. It's been moved. I was featured, or one of the selected artists from BAND, which is the Black Artist Network in Dialogue, and they combined with TD Bank did Black History Month. So my stuff was showcased at Fourth Eye Gallery, which is down on Parliament Avenue.
Okay.
So after that was done, now it's been picked up, and it's actually going to BAND's studio, BAND's location there.
Which is 1 Wilshire Avenue,
yes,
Suite 134.
Yes, so it's going to be there until the 31st, so it's a pretty good thing.
Wow, awesome. Congratulations, that's wonderful.
Thank you.
Now, do we have some of the images from that show that we can look at right now? I know we got something. I don't know if it's from the show or not.
You have my whole exhibition.
Let's look at some of these, and maybe you can comment on some of these.
Well, you asked me anything you want to ask, but it's
through them so quick. Let's look at each one.
It's a very unique. It's dance hall, so it's not like your average. Not the average person would go in there. So it's like the era's dance hall. It's a unique type of venue and event, and music and everything else.
So this is photography we're talking about,
this
right?
is photography.
Okay.
That I've been privy to go into different spaces over the years, and I've actually been in the space, and I've captured a lot of uniqueness, like from the fashion, because TD's, what they were looking for is then and now. So basically, I have a span of 21 or 22 years of photography. So we're looking at fashion, we're looking at individuals, their growth, artists, their growth, different things that have come to Toronto. Whatever has been to Toronto in the reggae genre, I've captured it.
So it's got to do with reggae, reggae music, the reggae culture.
Reggae culture, reggae, and then the subculture is dancehall. Reggae is the parent, dancehall is a child.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Do you know Culture Kid?
Culture Kid, I from Toronto, right?
Yeah.
But back in the days, because when I started, I was like downtown a lot, but no, he doesn't go. He's not hardcore like that anymore, you know?
Yeah, he used to do a
Bamboo
show here.
And stuff like that,
He used to do a show here at ThatChannel.
Oh, okay.
So I don't know if we can look at these images one at a time, or but let's talk about what's this one here.
This is actually I Wayne, and I was at a concert. This was like around 2 months ago, and I just saw this image. So I kind of set myself up, and I saw the image I shot that I wanted, and I went under, and I just saw it, and I said, yeah, that's it. So when I saw it, I knew exactly what I was getting.
So was he performing, obviously, on stage at this time? So you kind of have to lie down on the floor in front of the stage to get that?
No. It's just the angle of which I hold my camera.
Oh,
but I
wow.
saw this shot, so I kind of knew I was going to get that.
The color is amazing.
Yeah.
As long as you're not putting that camera on your shoes, it's okay.
No, I can put it on the shoes. It's where I'm looking up. That's that.
Okay. Can we look at some more there? Because
I must tell you that there's some disturbing pics in here. Because,
good.
Okay.
You know, yeah. You obviously took them for a reason, so let's...
I did. This is actually a Toronto artist sample. Sample King. The DJ is Fire King Steenie, and the sound that's playing in the background is the first CD sound in the world, and they're called Nitro. And this in Toronto, and this is a dance that happens. It's called daggering. And this is done came from Jamaica, and now Canadians do it, and this was done on stage.
It's called daggery.
Daggering.
Daggering.
Dagger.
Okay. Oh, my God. So it's like, is it like...
Stabbing.
Like, but not with the real thing.
Well, it's everything is sexual in dance hall.
Okay.
Right?
Okay. So it's like air guitar, air stabbing.
No, nothing to do with air guitar. Air guitar is too innocent for daggering.
Oh, okay.
Daggering,
wow.
Unfortunately, sometimes even...
We're going X-rated now, aren't we?
It's very X-rated, and sometimes it looks like... I have a picture in there where it actually looks like the girl is... She's in pain, because sometimes the guys will hold the girl's legs apart. You can go on YouTube. You can search it out.
We're trying
I'm not
to get
lying.
It on right,
right?
Now.
And they just they basically jump off into like jump off on her.
Is
you know.
Is this it here?
No, that one. This was a very iconic picture, because this is like Bogle, and Bogle is like a Jamaican dancehall icon, and he started the dance movement in Jamaica in the late early 80s, and he passed away. He got shot. But that was when he came to Toronto, and that was at the Concert Hall with Carla Marshall, which is our Canadian dance hall queen at the time.
Okay. What was going on in that photo?
There's a, like, if you go to dance hall, I'm telling you, if you go to dance hall, back then it was a lot of, we call it bubbling or now they call it grinding, but you know, we had it for years. It's called bubbling, and mm-hmm. you know, just bubble on a thing and wine on a thing, you know, yeah, he's just bubbling.
I know bubble tea.
If you could zoom in on her face, this is the one. I call this daggeration, because it actually looks like she's not enjoying this at all. You know, she's not enjoying that at all. But that's how it's done, and that's in Jamaica. That's at a place called Pasa Pasa. This
it's pass out maybe.
No, Pasa Pasa is like a big venue that if you're in the dancehall scene, that's something that's a must see. And that went on for like 7-8 years in Jamaica, in New Kingston. And everybody went from all over the world, went to Pasa Pasa.
Okay, so listen, this may be a really stupid question from somebody who is not aware of this kind of thing. Why would anybody engage in something that is not fun?
It is fun to them.
You just said she's not having
she
fun.
She doesn't look like she has. There's some willing participants. There is some willing participants, and then there's not, right? Because... When I'm sitting down and I'm watching BET and I see Beyonce doing the Dutty Wine. Dutty Wine comes from dancehall.
Right. Okay.
So I mean, there's
but
a lot.
She's having fun.
Dancehall is beautiful. It's just some people, like if they can find girls that are actually willing to participate, but sometimes you know they like people that they catch you off guard and they do that.
Okay.
But it's
okay.
Not. I shouldn't say it's not fun. She looks like she's not having fun, but it's not the norm. Let's say.
Okay. 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 Interesting. Okay.
Okay, we got some more shots we're going to look at.
Shots.
Now, do you just do dance hall, or do you all other kinds of photography?
I've done weddings and stuff of that nature, but I was a photojournalist for the Gleaner and the Star when I first started around 20 years ago, I used to work with the Jamaica Gleaner, Jamaica Star.
Okay.
I've gotten published in the Star here. I've gotten published with all the urban newspapers
magazines.
And magazines that used to be around in Toronto in the 80s and the 90s, so...
Wow, so you had quite the career.
Yeah, but I do a lot of dance hall and a lot of concerts and clubs and stuff
like
that.
Is that your
nature.
Love? Is that what you
that's
love
my
to do?
That's my passion. I think okay. I get better shots okay. like that because the vibrant, the, it's like a lifestyle. Those guys come out and they, from the way they dress to the way they move to the way they talk to what they do. I mean, this is one of my first pictures, my very first pictures that I ever took, and it got published in the paper. These guys were, they're called the Ouch Crew. This is like 1996. Now, I don't know if you know, but people weren't dressing like that. So dancehall is a little bit outrageous. It's a little bit out there. You know, people just want to be
very glamorous.
Yeah. It's like, I used to
it's
call
like Liberace.
It. Liberace. I call it like a ghetto Hollywood. That's what I used to call it. But I used to watch stuff from TV coming into the dancehall. I've grown to see stuff leaving from dancehall going on to TV, like the Dutty wine, like the clothing, because they're so unique in their style and their getup, you know. And this is some dancers from Jamaica, and they actually do this on, like they're on stage and they're dancing, but do it really fast. I just asked them to slow down, and I just took a picture of that.
Looks like you have to be quite athletic to do some of these steps too.
It's very physical because honestly, when I dance, I was so. When I went to clubs, I was so in shape. There's no time to get fat because you're always moving. You know what I mean?
Wow. Okay, so that should be coming to North America a little bit more.
Yeah, this is I call this a crossover. This is Master T and Much Music. And on the my left is Red Rat and Junior Fashion and Chanel, one of the first Toronto dancehall queens. And this is one of the first time that reggae dancehall was featured on mainstream TV, and this was like 1997.
Hey, whatever happened to Master T? I really like that guy.
I like him too. I hear he's still in Toronto, but I haven't seen him.
Yeah, he works at a record label now.
See? Wow.
So
well,
we want to
see Master T again.
Yeah, we do.
Okay, so this show is still on, right?
This show has moved from Fourth Eye Gallery.
And we're going to give it out again in a minute. I want to ask you before we get to that, like, is there a difference, or what would the difference be between the dance hall scene in Toronto, say, and the dance hall scene in Jamaica?
Well, back in the 80s or 90s, I would say that Canadians or Torontonians are trying to catch up with Jamaica. But right now, they're kind of on par because whatever happens in Jamaica happens... It happens in Canada. Like, let's say that they have theme dances, right? They'll have like a Pasa Pasa Monday or a Weddy Weddy Wednesday. They have that here now, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So you'll see, you won't see the difference. All you'll notice is that they're in Toronto and we're in Jamaica. The clothing is the same. They all dress the same. Like, wow. I mean, it's a very vibrant type of a lifestyle. And it's kind of uniformed. Throughout.
So if we mm-hmm. Skyped both in, we wouldn't be able to tell which one was from where.
You would have to ask, are these people from, right? Because you know it's Jamaica, because it's probably the environment of which it is. But the individuals mm-hmm. that are a part of it, they look like they could be an extra neighbor. They look like they could be here, right? England, again, is just the language right. difference that you might be able to detect. Their clothing's a little bit different, but I think the more, like you said, Liberace, the more unique you can be, the more out there you can be, the more you fit in.
The more appropriate it is.
Yeah,
wow.
yeah. Because that's one place where I've actually seen girls with very poor, like, they're not their attitude, but their self-esteem. They come in very low. And then within 2-3 weeks, they're like, oh, yeah, I'm on top
good.
Of the world. And it builds confidence to them. Like, it gives them a lot of confidence,
is
a
there,
lot of self-esteem.
Is there some of this in the Caravana Festival? Because there's a lot of that in the Caravana with the clothes.
Well, I think Caravana has its own uniqueness. But, because a lot of people, one of the things I noticed in Caravana, there's not a lot of is reggae, but as soon as the reggae flow comes down, Caravana is basically done. That's where people want to be because, you know, the attitude and everything else, it's kind of like a hype, you know?
Wow. Mm-hmm. So that's the pinnacle.
Well, I think so. People might argue, right? But I think so. I think dancehall is, reggae is it.
Wow. So what are you working on, or what's your next
My next project?
Project, yeah.
Well, I'm doing band, and I've mentioned, or people have mentioned, several of them, that they actually want to take it traveling. So I'd like to see
it's
it
like
go.
It's like a road show. Travel
yeah,
road show.
A road show. Like I call it on the road with the evolution of dancehall. So I'd like to see that happen, but I actually have thousands of images that are on 35mm that I'd like to get processed and develop and actually do some more mm-hmm. exhibitions and get them out, because now the majority of these pictures Like, this girl here, they call her Mama Bird, and look at her. Like, you wouldn't even believe. She's not the skinniest girl. She's probably not the best looking girl, but she owns what she's doing, and people are standing around and watching because she has taken control and charge. But
that's amazing.
I have so much images. I like to get them out there. All those things don't exist anymore. Like, you don't go out and see them. Now they're now into the posing. They're now into going out and just, you know, buying bottles of, and just hanging out, listening to the music. Back then, I used to dance and enjoy it. So I like to bring that to the forefront. That's what I like to do.
You want to see that come back?
I'd like to see. I don't know if I want to see all aspects, because I don't know if you're going to get a chance to see some of the pictures. People actually die, or have died in
Dancehall.
Like, people have gotten, like, I've seen
people. Because the dagger?
No, because of gunshot. Gunshots. It's sometimes it can be violent, right?
Okay.
And so I don't want to see all aspects of dancehall come back.
Of course. But so there's some one. Parts. There's one there.
I call that Last Breath. That was at that was 1996, and that was at Finch and Dufferin. This young man. I tried searching on the internet see if I can find him, but I couldn't. But I saw him basically. He was drawing his last breath. He was wheezing.
Is that from a gunshot?
Gunshot to the head.
By the way, do you know Johnny Smash by any chance?
Johnny Smash, I heard Johnny Smash.
Johnny Smash is going to be coming on the show in, I think, April, and he's going to be talking about black-on-black violence and how to stop it.
That would be nice.
And so that image there, of course, you know, just reminded me that Johnny Smash is going to be coming on the show to talk about that.
That's actually very disturbing.
It is, but I want to show every aspect of dancehall. I didn't want to leave anything out. It's not just about the prettiness, the fashion, and the
Yeah, because, you know, there's the other reality, too.
It's reality. It is.
Wow.
It is.
So, it's not on tour yet, so people in Toronto can still catch this show till March 31st at
the Band Gallery,
which is 1 Wiltshire Avenue.
Suite 134.
Yes.
And they can, I guess, go to the blackartanddialogue.com website. And what about, do you have a website, Lisa?
I do. I created one for the evolution of dancehall for me to remember it.
Do we have it somewhere?
Do we have it?
Is it on your card?
We're going to put it up. You just yell it out, because we want to tell people right now.
Lisa B Photos /Lisa Bailey. Oh, that's on Twitter.
Alicia B Photo. We're going to put it up in the credits. So just tune into the credits and people can check it out that way.
Yeah, okay. It's a long one.
All right, Lisa. Thanks for coming.
Well, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
The education. That was really interesting.
Well, I didn't do it in justice. I can't do it in 5 minutes. But if you have
a
chance,
are amazing, though.
Come down and
really
I'll definitely I'll definitely do some walkthrough and I can explain it better to you.
Wow.
Okay, great.
All right.
Thank you.
So we're just going to take a little break now, come back with, I don't know, Val and Max or Adam or somebody. And we're going to play a video right now of, we caught an alien on tape.
Another one.
Oh, and you can tell this one's
aliens.
Real. And then we're going to come back with somebody.
Okay. Aliens.
You know, I'm really pleasantly surprised at how today's show is going.
Why?
Are you?
No, I think it's going awesome.
Yeah, I know. That's what I'm saying.
Well, you're surprised that it's going awesome?
Just because I woke up in a bad mood today.
Oh, no.
That's because of the amazing Kreskin. He can turn that around.
Oh, see?
Yeah.
The sun was shining really early this morning, too.
Yeah, but that's why he woke up grumpy.
But now the snow is coming in, Val.
Yeah, but they say in like a lion and out like a lamb, remember?
Well, that's right. That's right, I forgot.
So you want it to be in like a lion and then out like a lamb.
Okay.
Early spring, baby.
Yep. But we're not March yet. That's until Friday. So we'll see how it goes.
Getting there close.
Okay. Anyway, okay, Val and Max, great to have you on the show as always.
Hello, everyone.
What's happening with the Superstarz?
Well, Superstarz is, we're really getting
wrapping up.
We're starting to wrap it up. And so we're going to be at the Birchmount Tavern.
Oh, we've
Birchmount
moved again.
Nightclub.
Okay.
We call it. At Birchmount and Danforth on the 24th of March.
Okay.
And more performing. So we'd like you to come out and judge that night.
Hugh, you want to go and judge?
March 24th?
Yeah, that's a Sunday.
Sure.
So it's 7 to 11.
Do they have good food there?
They have great food.
Really?
Yep.
What do they have?
Oh, they have wings, they have fries, they have steak, thick steak.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yes.
Do they have roast beef?
Oh, they have tons of roast beef, yeah. Yeah, roast beef, they got everything.
Has Max had the roast beef, Max?
You do have roast beef. Though?
But have you had it, though?
No, you haven't been there.
No, have you had it? Have you had it?
Oh, okay. Oh. All right. Just wondered.
So, I mean, it's really good, but we're getting down to the end, and I'm really looking forward to it. There's some really great contestants. So, Errol Starr will be there. It's like the semis.
Okay.
So, the finals. So, we're still going through.
I love Errol.
I know.
He performed here. He was so good.
I know. And he'll be there performing again.
Wow.
So, we're going to start at 11. Seven, but we say it'll end at 11, but I'm wondering if it might go on till midnight, which is fine.
Which is still not too late, even for Sunday night.
That's right. Yeah. That's why we're starting early.
That's doable.
Because we do have some kids.
You know, I'm looking forward to this already.
Oh, good.
Val.
Awesome.
So, now, is it the end? Is that the finals?
No, it's not the finals.
Okay.
There'll be two more shows after that. Because depending on how many we can get in on that Sunday night, we might have to go another Sunday to break up the singers.
Now, are the rest of the shows at the Birchmount now? Or is this
Well, pretty final? Well. They really would like us to do the rest of them at the Birchmount, if we can.
Okay.
But there's all kinds of other opportunities opening up, too, you were saying. So.
Yeah. That's a great town. Lots
some
of
great
stuff.
Talent.
Okay.
Some really good talent.
All right. Wow, anything else we need to tell people right now?
No, like I said, I have some guests from, you remember, I'm a volunteer. I volunteer in the community.
Yeah.
And I'm with the CPLC. And I'm arranging to have some of the members from the 54 Division come and talk to you about what the CPLC is.
What is it? What does it stand for?
It's a Community Police Liaison Committee. And what we do is we go out and we promote what's going on between, you know, in communities about safety and,
we had Kreskin on earlier.
Yes, that's
why
I wanted
to mention
it.
And he was talking about the police.
Yep.
And I just think it's amazing that you're mentioning this now. And
Thank
we
you.
Would love to have those guys on the show.
Yeah, and it's really true. They do have a lot of hats to bear these days.
Yeah.
They have to become a psychologist, a nurse, youth advocate. So they're everything nowadays. So two of them will be there. I'll probably come along as well. But two will be here to promote.
So is the whole point to try and bridge the gap with the community and the police?
Exactly.
So that they can, okay.
It's a good idea because, I think sometimes the community feels they want to feed back to the police, especially things after things like
G20.
Yes.
But they don't feel that there's a way for them to do that. And I'm hoping that CPLC is a way.
And the CPLC is that. We don't walk around with, police uniforms or anything.
Okay.
But, we still had to be, brought in properly into what we're doing. This is a very responsible position.
Yeah.
But people can come and talk to us about it. I've done it for 7 years and had a great time. We get to go all the parades.
It's a great idea.
Yeah. The parades?
Yeah. We go to parades and, taste the Danforth and we hand out stickers.
Nice. That's a great project to be a part of.
Yeah. So they'll come
in.
Okay. Well, I'll look forward to that. So now if people want to find out more about Superstarz, what do they do?
Yes. Superstarz with a Z.ca. Please go on the website.
Superstarz.ca.
Yeah.
Okay,
please
guys.
Please go on and get all the information and by all means come to the Birchmount on 24th.
Fantastic. Max, any final words?
Well, I'm going to be going to a camp and doing the March break. I'm going up to Whipbush to Zach's camp.
Oh.
Because he's doing like a 3-day songwriting and recording.
Who's Zach Warner?
Yeah.
Yes. Former judge of Kane and I. He has a great, great great school called the Zach Werner Idol School, which I've been going for the last 2 years now.
Okay.
Best school I've ever went.
Yeah.
Great.
I can't believe you need schooling on music, Max, knowing that you're the artist
the
that you are.
Not schooling like I would have had a long time ago.
Yeah, I know.
And it's good to see, like, young kids, like, you know, like, I'm with the adult people, like, they're, like, in their, like, mid-teens to, like, you know, young adults to, like, guys in their 20s.
That's good. Nice.
Okay, guys, so check out superstarz.ca.
Yep.
Thanks, Max, and thanks, Val. We're going
to
watch.
You guys. So nice to see
you. No problem. Good to see you guys, too. Great.
Okay, we're going to watch a little video and come back with Adam Jang, our final guest of the day, as Liquid Lunch continues. So we got something here about the Bank of Canada. We're going to watch this and come back with Adam
right
after this.
I prefer sacred economy.
Maybe they're giving away money. Who knows?
Oh.
Well, it's legislation that creates a public bank for public use by the government for its population. It's the only G8 country that actually has a public bank that's accountable to the government and created by the government. Other central banks, including the United States of America, are private banks, and that's where the problem starts. Now, since 1974, our bank has been taking marching orders from the Bank of International Settlements, which is based in Switzerland, where the private bankers make currency and fiscal policy decisions that our bank follows and adheres to, even though under statute and under our constitution, the bank is answerable to the Minister of Finance under Section 14, and Cabinet is the ultimate decision maker on fiscal policy through the Finance Minister and the currency and whatnot. And so that bank is there for use and security for Canadians as required, as needed by the governments in executing socioeconomic planning.
Okay. So can you sum up, like, in about 30 seconds or more, what the lawsuit is specifically against, who and whom?
Well, the lawsuit is against the Minister of Finance, and it's a two-tier challenge. The first is to restore the Bank of Canada to one of its original and current legislative purposes, which is to provide interest-free loans for human capital infrastructure like hospitals, education, roads, and whatnot. And the second is to force the finance minister in the budgetary process, when the budget is brought down every year, to accurately and truthfully tell us how much tax was collected or collectible before they published their net revenue. And just to explain that for a second, they only give us the aggregate amount of revenue collected after the transfer of tax credits back to corporations and taxpayers. Okay. So for instance, they say we collected $240 billion, we're spending $280 billion, we have a deficit of $40 billion. That's not true. They collected or could collect maybe $300-400 billion, transfer back tax credits, and then they publish the net revenues collected. Well, that distorts the real picture, because if our parliamentarians knew how much money is collected or collectible, we could have a different view of how much tax credits we want to kick back and whether or not we need a deficit every year.
Okay, so it's basically like a false statement or a false.
It's improper accounting methods, which hides the real picture. Now, typically, our deficit every year coincides with the lion's share of interest we're paying to foreign and commercial domestic banks on our debt, which is bizarre, because our commercial banks get their money from the Bank of Canada right today at the lowest interest rate, which is 0.25%. They in turn often loan it back to the governments, and the government, our government, pays back commercial interest rates. So there's something wrong with this picture.
Yeah, there is. And you were saying earlier that currently the Bank of Canada Act, is it active? Is it still owned by Canadians?
The Bank of Canada Act is still an act that's in force. Of course it's active. It's ignored by the government.
So it's ignored.
It's simply ignored. And worse than ignored, we say it's being subverted.
Subverted?
Yeah. It's being subverted by the government. And furthermore, we have a constitutional doctrine in Canada that the parliament and the government cannot relinquish its duty to govern. That's what they're doing with respect to banking and the Bank of Canada Act. They're pretending that they are hands-off and that the government has nothing to do with fiscal policy through the bank. That's not true. Under Section 14, if there's a dispute between the governor of the Bank of Canada and the Minister of Finance, with the consent of Cabinet, the Minister of Finance can issue a directive to the governor of the bank, and he has to follow it. Because it's ultimately, the bank is not only created, but answerable to Parliament.
So they're answerable to Parliament.
Yeah.
Thank you. Because Canadians have always wondered whether or not they've had the authority to, you know...
Watch your head.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, we're back here on the show, and we got Adam Jang joining us. That's his guitar playing, and Adam is here all the way from Vancouver. So, Adam, when did you get to town?
When did I get in town? I got in town about 2 days ago, bro.
How did you get here?
How did I get here? I flew, man.
Did you?
Boy, my arm's tired. All right. But anyways, yeah, I got into town 2 days ago. I rocked a little place down by Chinatown last night. Got a little band together that I put together last night.
You put together a band last night?
Yes, I did. I put a band together last night.
And what do you call this band?
I don't know.
Last minute band?
Okay, it's last minute band.
No, you know what I thought was cool was that, because I asked you about this, because you didn't bring a band from Vancouver. You just came into town by yourself and just went around and actually
Insta
was
band.
Able to gather a band together.
Yes,
Insta band.
Because I'm damn good, bro.
Well, that's what you call Insta band.
Instaban at Just Add Water. Just Add Whiskey.
Yeah.
A little bit of pot. And it works out fine.
Never any mistakes, never out of tune.
There we go. Perfect. All the time. Right? So, I just got in. Got a show going out this Friday down at the Vapor Lounge on Yonge Street, 665 Yonge Street, about 9:30 if y'all want to come out.
At the Vapor Lounge. Now, Sandra, do you know what a Vapor Lounge is? Just curious.
Okay. Okay.
Do you know what the Vapor Lounge is?
Thank you.
I actually have to admit I've
never gone into the Vapor Lounge
before.
I've
been to the Vapor Lounge.
Mm-hmm. Is this like a swing?
I couldn't believe
it. Is this a swinging club?
Don't tell her.
You know what? You know, I can't believe.
You sure you don't want to come down now?
What is this?
Okay, I gotta say, Adam, I couldn't believe it when I went to the Vapor Lounge.
You couldn't believe it?
I couldn't believe it that this is Toronto, not Vancouver, not Amsterdam. I went into that place.
Okay,
and I was like, oh my God.
Okay.
I mean, it's just incredible.
I would get a headache if I went there, right?
Everybody smokes pot. Everyone's not cool to admit it, but everybody smokes pot. Just occasionally, if it's around, right, and stuff, and you're like, no, not everyone goes out and looks for it or anything like that, right? Not everyone thinks
See,
it's
I
a
really
great thing.
Knew what it was. I was just joking.
Of course you know what it is. You're rad. Look at you. You're smiling right now. Look at that.
So
we're not saying
anyways,
what we did before the show, though.
The Vapor Lounge. So that's your gig coming up this Friday.
Yes, sir.
That's awesome. And now how long are you in town for, and what else are you going to be doing?
I think I'm just
going
to stay.
You're not going back?
No, I think this is good. What, you don't want me here?
No, I think that's amazing, but most people go back.
Yeah, no.
Because the people who love Vancouver love Vancouver. They don't love Toronto.
Well, it's you know...
There's a big, big split between the Vancouver-type people and Toronto-type people. Well, it's like L.A. and New York.
Well, the thing is, like, in the last 3 months of being in Vancouver, I gigged maybe 2 times.
Oh.
I've managed to get over that already, being here for 2 days. And this is like the mecca of the entertainment world in
wow.
Canada. Right? It's like little New York for everybody. As everybody
are you telling
knows.
Me the people in Vancouver couldn't even appreciate your hair? Like that alone is worth performing.
Everybody can appreciate my hair worldwide, ma'am.
I'm appreciating it right now.
Those are beautiful locks.
I appreciate your hat, man. And thank you. You too.
So, Adam, do you want to do a song for us? We'd love to hear one and get a little sample.
Song. Normally, I'm a lead guitar player. We don't have our bass and the drums and all that stuff. So
you're the Insta Man band.
That doesn't happen right now. Yeah, but I'll play a little song. Right, this is called "Some of My Friends Are Drug Dealers."
And they hang out the Vapor Lounge.
Sure. That's right, baby. You can dig it. Cool people clap, guys. Sound guys. Some of my friends are drug dealers, and some of my friends are dead. Some of my friends are drug dealers, and some of my friends are dead. Some of my friends are dead. I woke up early this morning to my sweet angel telling me that my best friend died last night, shot to death for a kid. Deeds caught up with him. Didn't really seem that odd for the fella for his dirty deeds to do him in. 'Cause some of my friends are drug dealers, and some of my friends are dead. Some of my friends are drug dealers, and some of my friends are dead. I ain't got one damn worry, laying all alone in my bed. Some of my friends are drug dealers, and some of my friends are dead.
Oh, yeah, you're new in town.
New in town, hook me up.
Nice. I'll hook you up.
Thanks,
you
baby.
You will? I'd like to see that.
Well, I walked to the funeral home to see my good buddy to his grave. The priest said his spirit was God blessed. Too bad his life couldn't be saved. I saw his woman crying, and I let a tear fall on my shoulder. Told me she should come back to my place, and we could talk things over. Yeah. That's right. That 15 grand's mine. Some of my friends are dead.
Woo. Wow. You have an amazing voice.
Thank you.
Yeah. You know, that kind of reminded me, I know, because you mentioned you're a lead guitar player.
Yes.
That kind of reminded me, maybe it's because it's kind of unplugged session, but yeah. Kind of reminded me of Bruce Coburn a little bit.
Sweet.
Yeah.
That's
Thanks,
a really
man.
Nice
yeah.
compliment.
Cool. Appreciate that, man.
Wow.
So,
but again, playing this Friday, come out, give me money and drugs, and everything will be good. All right? This Friday, 9:30.
Well, you're
lounge.
Speaking from the heart.
Okay, Adam, so wait, you're here in town, and it's a career move, I know. Cause aren't they putting together, like, a documentary or something
about you? Yeah, they're putting a little documentary together for me and following me around with cameras and stuff, but that doesn't start till next week.
Okay.
Who's doing that?
But, I don't remember his name or his company.
His management.
Yeah.
His management team's putting the whole thing together. And yeah. What's the long-term goal for you as a musician? You're here in Toronto now. You might stay, it sounds like, but what's the plan?
I would like to get steady work as a musician.
Yeah.
That's what I'd like to do. I don't want to really work a day job. I'm not, like, being a rock star, that'd be fantastic, and be given $10 million for nothing. That'd be fantastic, right? But that's not really realistic. What's pretty realistic is that I could go play wherever the hell you want, anybody wants me to play at, right?
Wait, are you saying you're tired of standing in line at clubs you'll never get in?
I think so. What line's that from? What lyric's that?
It's, I hate to say it, but it's a Nickelback song.
It's a Nickelback song.
Oh.
Nickelback. Someone's having a midlife crisis.
Is it Chad? Is he having a midlife crisis?
Oh, yeah, me and Chaz, we go way back.
It's Chad.
No, me and Chaz, we go way back. Oh, yeah, me and Chester Chazzy. Oh, yeah, we used to play pool and stuff back
in Alberta. Okay, so do you know how they got the name Nickelback?
They no. How did they get the name Nickelback?
Do you know how?
No.
Okay, apparently, because he used to work at Starbucks out in Alberta or wherever he's from. Yeah. And every time someone bought a coffee or a latte, he would give them a nickel back because it was like $1.95 or $3.95 or whatever, and he'd give them a nickel back. That's what I understand.
Oh.
I heard that at the Vapor Lounge.
They're stoned out of their mind there.
She may have imagined it. Okay, Adam, so... Okay, this Friday at the Vapor Lounge, what time do you go on?
9:30.
And yeah. Any other gigs lined up, or are you still working on it?
What was the woman, Valerie? 24th.
Oh, yeah.
March 24th at the Birchmount Tavern. And,
This is awesome. I like this gangster bling you got on. Can we get a close-up of this?
These are the immortality rings. It's a long story, Adam.
That's pretty boss.
They make you physically immortal if you wear these things.
Oh, so it's like the Q-ray, but for white people.
Way better than the Q-ray. Q-ray is so, like, 20th century.
All right.
He will never die.
He will never die.
No.
Okay, that's good.
He's immortal.
And let's invest into him.
Yeah.
Adam, do you have a website or something that people can...
Yes, I have a couple websites. You can check out my SoundCloud at soundcloud.com/Mr-AdamJang. You can just Google my name and into Google or YouTube, and I'll come up. Just put in Adam Jang. It's only 8 letters, bros. You guys can do it.
soundcloud.com/Mr. That's
Dash.
M-R? M-R or M-R. M-I-S? Okay.
M-R.
Okay.
No, I'm not Mrs. Mr. Dash Adam Jang. I caught that, you bastard.
No, it could have been M-I-S-T-E-R.
That's what I was getting at.
Mister. That's, yeah. Is that how you spell Mister?
Yeah. 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 M-I-S-S-E-D-H-E-R.
Yeah.
It's shorter.
Mister.
That's why. Okay, Adam, you know what I love? We're going to end the show now. And thanks for coming and doing this. And all the best in Toronto and everywhere else you go.
You are one unique individual.
Thank you. So are you.
But would you take us out with a song? And we'll run the credits over it, and it'll be super awesome.
Okay.
What's this song called? Do people live in this song?
We're just gonna do an old Pat Travers song. Snorting whiskey, drinking cocaine. Snorting whiskey, drinking cocaine. Drive that girl insane. You're better, baby.
There are moments in history where great civilizations are tasked with reinventing themselves or risking collapse.
And you're all over town. Sure as hell ain't down. Snorting whiskey, drinking cocaine.